I live now in California, a strange and volatile state, a whole Pacific nation with 22 million people, and we have a governor who is a Zen Buddhist Jesuit. Now, this is practically a resistible combination. He's called Jerry Brown, and his second go at the governorship, his second term is over, and he wants to go to the United States Senate, and I would like to go to the United States Senate, so we may be, we have to always say this very carefully, we are both thinking seriously about running in 1982, which is a little over a year away, but you plan early and you run hard. In England, you stand for election, we run. That is one of the many differences between our great lands.
Every American boy is told that he could become president. Do you still believe you could become president?
Every American girl now is also told she can become president. The presidency, I don't think, is anything you really want to have now, because the political situation is such that the actual governing of the United States is not done by the president or by the Congress. It's done by the Chase Manhattan Bank, a very important bank, the oil companies, the defense industries, people in boardrooms around the United States. We have a law, really, that the better known you are, the more publicity you get in a country like the United States, the less power you have. The country is run by people with names like Mellon, that nobody knows anything about. So what they do is they hire lawyers, sneaky lawyers like Richard Nixon, and they put him in to be the president. He gets all the attention, all the publicity, but they do the actual governing.
Why do you want to be in politics?
Why would I want to be? Well, because I would be, first of all, I'd be the candidate against the Chase Manhattan Bank and the candidate against the oil companies, which means an awful lot of money would be put up to see that I was defeated, and there might be enough put up to affect that. On the other hand, there are occasionally you have a chance for a citizen politician to come in. One person isn't going to do much of anything in the United States Senate, but you have a chance to sort of say who's stealing what from whom and try to expose the system from within. And I think it's a useful thing to do. Anyway, I'm so genetically arranged that I am obliged to be a candidate. It isn't really that it's a thing that you would sanely choose. Anyway, I'm a natural politician, alas. And
then do you think you've wasted your life?
I haven't wasted my life, but I would like to have been two people. I certainly never wanted to be a writer, but I was born one. It's just like being, being double-jointed or having perfect pitch. It's something that you're born with. You don't necessarily want to do it. As I began to read my first book, called The Duck and the Kangaroo, I was about 6 years old. It was a tale of unnatural vice between a duck and a kangaroo. I found myself writing a book the same time I was reading one.
So you were born not only with a silver spoon in your mouth, but a fountain pen in your right baby fist, were you?
A silver spoon, I think silver
tongue.
That
must have been very uncomfortable, wouldn't it?
I think silver tongue is the phrase you're looking for. My family had no money. We were political and connected with just about everybody by marriage, but my end was penniless. So all we had were our wits to live by.
You weren't a privileged child. I always thought you were.
No, I was privileged in the sense that I was brought up in a family of senators and military people and politicians, and my family managed to marry just about everybody, but there were certain sections of the family that were very rich and others that were not. Ms. Onassis, as she is known now, is also in my same situation. We both had a stepfather who was extremely rich, but neither of us had a penny, so she had to pursue wealth in her way, and I had to write for a living and do other things to make a living.
So is wealth the only class or caste that exists in America?
I would say no. We have a complex class system, like all democratic societies that have no class system. Ours is so complicated that you almost can't describe it. I think the nice thing about the political arrangement in America is that you can go all through your life without ever knowing anything about what class you belong to. Or if you get interested in it, it's like Proust, or Byzantium. Yeah, we have
But it's based upon what, then? Power?
It's based mostly upon money, as it is practically anywhere else, even though the great English families, as they lose their money, then they have their glorious names and their schools, which maintains your class system. We have our schools, we have our managerial class. I just went back to my old school, Exeter. which is a, what you would call a public school here. It must be, it's not a grand one like Eton, it's something like Winchester. It's sort of for rather bright boys on the make who will then become presidents of banks and things. And I realized I hadn't been back since I graduated, and they were having their 200th birthday, the school. As I looked around, I said, you know, it hadn't occurred to me what a deliberate thing this school was. How deliberately we were being shaped to be the managers of the United States, of the banks and of the brokerage houses and of the law firms. Not so much in politics, that was a little vulgar. We were to be the people behind the scenes running the country. And I thought, really, they knew what they were doing, the American ruling class, since we were not the rich boys, but we were the ones who were considered rather sharp. And we were employed at 14. We'd already been co-opted by the actual rulers of the country. And they do know, we've got a very clever ruling class. They've been in business 200 years. And they've managed to fool most of the people most of the time. They don't even exist. Now, that is genius.
You've been away from America for a long time, though. I know you're now back in California.
No, I've never lived away. I've always kept a place in Italy. And there have been times when I go there to do my work, because if I'm in America, I'm always in politics. But I keep a foot, as it were, in both in the peninsula of Italy and in California. So I've never been, as they say, an expatriate. English never understand this. They hear that a successful writer or actor or whatever is living out of his own country. They say, ah, for tax reasons. A bit of news for the English is that every American pays full tax to the United States government, no matter where he lives, and no matter where he makes his money. You could leave the United States tomorrow, never come back for 30 years, earn your living in Afghanistan, and the Americans would insist that you pay full tax. No other country is so arrogant or so oppressive in its tax laws. So all my time in Italy, I was paying American tax. There was no advantage.
How is America these days?
How is America these days? Well, I was taking America's temperature just last week, and it's slightly higher than normal. We have 60 million handguns in private hands, and you can see what happens now as they keep shooting presidents in one another. I would say the country is in a disturbed state. Ulysses S. Grant was one of our greatest men, not a good president, but a great general, and a marvelous memoirist. Gertrude Stein and I both agree that he's perhaps the best American prose writer. He said something very interesting. He was a young West Pointer in the War of 1847, which we tore a big chunk away from Mexico, which is now California, Texas, and so on. And he hated that war. And then later when the Civil War came, and he writes this in his memoirs, he said, I think that nations, like individuals, they must pay a price for their ill deeds. He said, our war against Mexico was as wicked and unjust as any European war. And he said, I think the Civil War was the vengeance and the judgment of God on the American people. Well, I think the judgment of God is on the American people for what we did in Vietnam. And the economy is cracking up. We are losing we are ninth in per capita income in the world today, and the United States is sort of, the compass is just spinning round, round, round. Nobody knows where true north is, and the times are bad.
If politicians did have power in your country, which I presume you do love, do you?
The country. Why bother with it if you didn't? You were drawn to that. You were drawn to make it better than it is, but you also find yourself against a vast machine, which includes television, the press, and the various banks that do indeed own the country, in which dissent of any kind is immediately dispelled as quickly as possible. So you have great difficulty in getting to the people. Half of our population, half of our electorate, never votes at all. And the other half votes but does not know that we don't have political parties. Can you imagine a country that size? We're not allowed to. We have one party which has two wings. One is called Democratic, the other is called Republican. Each is financed by the same oil companies, the same defense industries. And the politicians are interchangeable. Reagan's program will be marginally different from Carter's, but essentially it'll be the same. So the people are beginning to catch on. And every time we start to have a political party, something goes wrong. In 1912, I think it was, the Socialist Party polled over 1 million votes, our one party with two wings got so upset that the noble Woodrow Wilson, the only thing he could think to do was put in jail the head of the Socialist Party under his wartime acts, and that was the end of that party. They act very quickly to get rid of dissent. This is why I'm a figure that does not exactly fill them with joy.
Do you think your fame would be an advantage if you do stand as senator, or do you think it's almost a disadvantage? I'd like to use one of your quotes, which was about another writer and sage, Marshall McLuhan, when you said everybody thinks they've read him because they've read so much about him. And I think that probably applies to you, doesn't it?
Oh, I'm sure it applies to me. Is it more?
Do you think there's a danger in being known for being well known?
I think there is, in politics, no danger at all in being known for being well known.
As a writer?
As a writer, you're only going to appeal to 5% of our people read books. So there's a whole vast majority that does not read books. I have, curiously enough, coming as I do from, I suppose the word is the left, I have exactly the same advantage as a politician that Ronald Reagan had, except that I don't have the money. He was picked by the rulers because the American people had seen him between the movies and television commercials for 50 years. And it's never whether they like him or dislike him. They're used to him. They have been watching me on television for 30 years. Since 1931 years, I have been part of the national furniture. Do they like me or not? That's not important. I'm like the chair on your set, you know. I've been around forever. So you could almost say anything. I could almost say, yes, I believe we probably should drop a nuclear bomb on Washington. They say, oh, there's Gore again. Isn't that interesting?
So nobody pays any attention to you?
They don't. They do and they don't. But what does work is that they're so used to you. Mm. And in a funny way, I would be the Reagan of the left, because he got in really because the rulers wanted somebody, first of all, somebody who could read cue cards for the
So you reckon that the public facade of politics is sheer showbiz.
I think
and
it's
you'd
totally
be marvelous at that.
I'm perfectly good at that.
Because
content is not very important, as you know.
The only